everybody have a chance to look at the minutes that Corey sent for the 13th?
I move that they be accepted as written and presented.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? No.
Good job, Corey.
Okay, and we'll turn it over.
Can I ask a question?
Oh, sorry, yes, and Dennis wanted to do this thing.
Okay, I just got a question. If the school could give us for the last 3 years the standard test and the number of tests.
If you bring that to the board, that'd be great, to the school board. That'd be great.
Thank you. So next time you bring it.
Okay.
And I'm sorry, Dennis wanted a quick minute to talk about the water real quick before we start.
I know everybody's got water flyers out. But we have Scott with them, we always had him, and he's a water guy. So he's going to be with us for a year. And come to find out, the previous road agent, really, he left in a hurry, so.
You mean superintendent?
Superintendent. Did I say road agent?
Yep.
I'm sorry.
Well, he also
I'm looking at George. But no, he left, and there were some things that he didn't do. He didn't carry it through, so that's why we have some problems. Scott McGinn said, the pH has been adjusted. Well, it's mostly quarter well, I'm talking about the one in Dr. Legion. And they're doing constant checking on all the test sites. And when testing, there is arsenic in the quarter well. But at the testing sites, there's no arsenic showing. So that's good. They're working on that well up there. Uric acid, they're doing a combination of things. And so that's about, and So the lead and copper, that was another screw up. They didn't test it in early, and it never got tested until sometime in November. And the state was upset with that, so that's why we got a violation there, you know.
Quick question?
Yeah.
So, how long has it not been tested?
It was tested in June. It's mostly a quarter.
Okay. So, I know that you said it's not life-threatening and all of those things, but how would it affect a baby?
It's young, you know, it's very young. I don't know, you know. I can't answer that question. You know, but if it's getting to the tower and it's not being recorded, so it's got to be, you know, it's not the arsenic got in there. So it's
not
all
talking about the copper.
Oh, the lead and copper? No, that's fine. I think that was an error, a clerical error, you know, more or less.
I know, but still in the water.
Yeah, it was a clerical error. It was something that he didn't do. So they.
I understand that, but.
Yeah.
I have two babies in my household, and I just want to make sure that they should they be tested, or is it?
How old is your pipes? Are they galvanized
pipes?
Yeah. How old are they?
Oh, I don't know. 100
years
old.
100 years old?
Yeah.
No. So you probably got, did you have pipes replaced? I had galvanized pipes in my house 5 years ago. I had a replacement copper. I can't tell you that.
Okay. So
have you ever had the water tested in your house?
They did it a couple of times when they were testing well behind my house.
Okay.
They'd use my house as a test study.
If they're using General Sullivan, you won't get lead and copper in your well.
Oh, okay. So it's only the one down by the region as well?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's the one by the region. It's a deep water well.
Okay. That's all I need to know. Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. I know.
Oh, sorry, Suzanne.
I realize that we're doing something special, so in that light. Are you keeping the water district folks apprised of what's going on?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
We got a letter.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
right.
We have a letter.
From the water district, yes.
We posted them in the post office.
Thank you.
No, you can have a few seconds.
Thank you. Okay.
And if you have any problems, call Rick. We have a new guy right in the middle. I'm a
medical advisor. It's not the well behind my house, which I'm assuming that's the well.
Yeah, that's the well that's behind.
So, thank you.
Any other questions?
No. Yeah, not going anyway. You got the budget.
Okay, Suzanne.
All right, thank you. So, I'm involved in all of these presentations tonight, so I'm going to sort of stage it the way I think probably needs most efficacious. I am starting with the Highway Department and the Transfer Station, because I'm the road agent here, and so he will be here to answer questions and talk about things, but I will do the initial presentation. And I'm going to start by saying that from a background point of view, we were in desperate straits when our road agent gave us 2 weeks' notice sometime in August. And, you know, we were in the middle of a culvert project funded by the USDA, and it was just a difficult time for us. But we did form a search committee with some really good folks who helped us along, and as a result of that search committee, we hired George Gilmet, who's our new road agent. If you haven't met him, he's here. An outcome from that search committee was a recommendation to hire a full-time Highway Department assistant, which we had started to do planning-wise for this year, 2018. And both George and some other members of that committee got in touch with the board and said, hey, you need to hire this person now, and you can't wait. And we were having trouble finding you know, seasonal plow drivers who had CDLs. That was one of our problems. So we not only hired George, we also hired Ed Walsh, who was from Acton, Maine, who serves on the select board. And so in Acton. And so he's very much aware of the constraints that town and municipal budgets work under. And from, again, sort of setting the stage, I mean, I think it was an expense, there's no doubt about it, it's an additional expense to have a full-time assistant. But we have, there's a real do-it-yourself attitude on the part of our Highway Department staff that we are very pleased with, and the town will be pleased with. And what you'll see in this budget as I go through it is an emphasis on supplies and materials, because they'll be doing stuff themselves, and a de-emphasis on some of the contracted services. So I do have like a highlight sheet. I don't know if any, did people need it? It's also being displayed, but we'd like to see it. So with the hire of our road agent, there is an increase in the salary of the road agent. Of the full-time assistant is probably a gross increase of $64,000 when you consider health and retirement and the like. But because we've cut down on part-time health, the net budgeted increase is about $56,000. And why a full-time assistant? We were advised by the search committee that we needed to build redundancy in the Highway Department staff, that it was difficult to get the part-time. It's a lot more difficult to find people in a part-time capacity with CDLs than it is to hire full-time. And we were having a heck of a time finding CDLs to employ drivers. And many of our Highway Department projects, if we are going to do them in-house, that we're either required to have at least 2 people for OSHA reasons, or it's just it's required to have it in order to get the job done. And now we can provide 24/7 coverage without burning out our staff, which we were not able to do when we had one road agent. So there's a real do-it-yourself philosophy in the Highway Department staff. There's a willingness to do repairs and maintenance in-house to the extent possible. That increases the supplies and materials lines, decreases some of our contracted services lines, like line striping, roadside mowing, and we are exploring doing our own street sweeping with the skid steer. You'll see stormwater management is in the is there on the Highway Department budget, and with an increase that brings it to $5,000, and if you ask, well, what do you plan to do with it, we're not entirely sure, but this is the year when the MS4 permit becomes effective on July 1, and we need to file a notice of intent by October 1st, and so we need to have some budget dollars available in order to either hire a consultant for a brief period of time to do something for us, either a mapping of an outfall or whatever, or testing an outfall, and that sort of thing. Road maintenance, as you heard me say, the entire road maintenance, but road maintenance is in the operating budget. The plan is to do Roberts Farm in the Woodlands. We're going to do all of one, and as much of the others we can do within a $300,000 paving The rest of the $25,000 will go toward associated costs with the development work, like new shoulder work or detail, you know, traffic detail, and then small projects throughout the town. And just an FYI, we've already heard from Pike that they've announced an increase in asphalt as of January 1st. So that's the highway. I can go right on to the transfer station and capital projects, and then you can just, I'll open it up, George, to answer all of your questions. Transfer station, there's an increase in the attendance line that both supports an increase in their hourly rates, but also more hours. We've added 120 hours to cover brush chipping. So again, they're going to be doing in-house brush chipping, contracting it out, which is an overall savings. Not much, but maybe $1,500 to $2,000. There's a decrease in trucking municipal solid waste, which we expected. The decrease could be higher than we have budgeted, but we're not sure. We didn't get that second compactor online until late in the season, so we're not entirely sure how much we're going to save, so we're trying to be conservative there. And there was also a lot of uncertainty up until pretty much the end about the trucking cooperative that we're part of with other towns in the Lambert Regional Cooperative. And there was a slight increase in the tipping fees that was contractual. It goes up by a little bit per ton for the next 5 years or for every year of the contract?
The contract is 10 years and we are on our third year.
Right, does it keep going?
Yeah, it goes up a dollar every year up until year 7, and then it's like $1.50, and then $1.50, and then back down to $1 the last 2 years, or something to that effect.
All right, thank you. Thank you. I hope you didn't mind by just kind of...
Sorry.
Thank you. Sorry. So those are sort of the highlights of the transfer station and capital projects. There are two related capital projects, both funded entirely by the CIP. One is we're back again with a highway department service truck, which we did not buy in 2017. So we have the full full $20,000 that was budgeted for that, and an additional $22,000 in CIP, and a roadside mowing attachment for $12,000 that we'll put on the Bobcat to do roadside mowing ourselves and not contract that out. With that, Michelle, you can questions. They'll go to George first if there's something you can't answer on.
How much was our contracted brush cutting in prior years? Do you remember?
$35,000. It's in the look at the budget.
In the budget.
Yeah, let's see it. There are that one. Disbanding it, but it won't happen in 2018. So that's the hauling that we expect to have a decrease on. The other one is Shipyard. They haul the single stream recycling in. And it's not contractual. So their monthly fees, they can go up month by month, which is how we've been operating since they came on board. So we had I don't want to say generous, but we didn't want to get caught short, so we had a budget, an ample budget, to cover possibilities. And this is the third year, and, you know, if we've had more than enough money, so I think we also cut that one by $1,000, the shipyard.
Just an observation with Shipyard is, and it's not budget related, but I think it is in the sense that we're paying them to do a job, is going down Route 4 behind them. Last week, might have been Thursday, but I'm not 100% sure, and they didn't have their canvas down, and all the trash was blowing all over the night. So it's
So somebody should just mention to them that, I don't know who the driver was, but if I had friends here for a family thing, and they were like appalled, and of course I look and I'm like, oh my God, it's ours.
You know, it's ours, aren't coming up.
Well, the shipyard came out of Roberts Road, and we followed him out of Roberts Road, so I'm pretty sure it was ours.
Okay. All right.
But he pretty much left a ton of our trash back in the moment.
Well, actually, it's a violation of DOT regs.
It is.
It was
so noted.
Quite a bit.
So the staff now is two full-time people and one part-time person, is that correct?
It's not a part-time person, it's part-time support.
Like our call?
Well, it's roadside, seasonal, not roadside, seasonal plow. There is someone who's there 3 days a week right now.
Just to follow up, so George, can you tell me how your job has changed where you can earn a 9.5% increase after a few months?
Susan. There's been no 9.5% increase in George.
It says road agent 9.5%.
No, the budget. From 2017 to now, this we hired him at a rate, and he's staying at that rate.
Oh, okay. All right. So it's from last year to this
year.
It's
a it was a stress.
They had you working overtime.
He was thinking it's going to be Christmas.
Okay. Now, sorry to be unclear about this. Strictly, you know, it's the increase in the budget from last year to this year, and it covers
from the last person in that position.
Yes.
Yeah.
Got it.
Denise, I just need clarification. The brush chipping, is that actually being done at the transfer station? Is that when people bring their stuff in and then you're putting it through a thing to break it down a little bit?
It will be.
Okay, but it's not roadside chipping or
right.
whatever.
No, that's
right
a separate.
Down. That's
roadside
a separate.
Separate.
Thank you.
Yeah,
I'll just add to that, you know, it's when people bring their brush and stuff to the transfer station and it piles up. We used to burn it.
Mm-hmm.
And it created an issue with abutters, and so we stopped burning it. And our prior road agent felt the best way to manage it was to get somebody to contract somebody to come in here, chip it, and haul it away.
Mm-hmm.
And so, because of the lateness of the year this year, George did have someone come in and do it for less than the budgeted amount and haul it away. But in the future, we are going to be doing our own chipping with our chip.
You have to chip it, so I figured.
Mm-hmm.
You'd like the people we have.
Because you can do it more often versus a big pile. You can do
we'll
it as
we'll just keep
yeah.
we'll just pile up the chips, and if we have to haul them off, we will.
Mm-hmm.
But a free sign,
yeah.
Well,
yeah. Can we go over the budget page by page, and then any questions on that page?
Absolutely.
Okay, Dennis.
How old's the chip right now? I remember they bought them back.
I'm not exactly sure. I didn't find.
I
remember they bought it.
They bought it. It was like $10,000 when they bought it.
Oh, I'm sure.
So it's in good shape.
Yeah, it's not in bad shape. We used it quite a bit already this summer. Mm-hmm. We had some point stops.
Yeah.
Sure. I'm proposing to start from the beginning and not finish our way.
We're going to pilot instead, right?
I'm going to go through the highway first.
That's
no
just
problem.
Because I think she wanted to.
Right, I think she's
okay.
trying
okay.
to
no problem.
Splitting it up. On.
That's fine.
While George is here.
The equipment line item, increase of $6,000, you have $1,400 for the trailer. What is the other $4,600?
I'd like to address that if I can.
$186. Sorry, what?
$186. So, one of the things that I discovered this year is that we were putting on the vehicle repairs and making some expenses that I thought were actually really equipment to the plows, to the radio equipment that was associated with the vehicle. And so we moved them to that line. And so the rest is just, you know, we needed there to manage the plows, deal with any radio issues. If you look at the line, I think we've had it, it's about $7,000 expended as of the end of November. And so as a steady state with older equipment, it just seemed like a prudent budgeting move.
So no plan other than the trailer. And, well, what is the cost for the explosion proof flammable storage?
I haven't priced the cabin itself. They're upwards of $800-$900, you know, depending on the size you get. I mean, right now we're using a metal module, which is not at the cost.
Suzanne?
Just maybe a clarification. That's not only for new equipment, which some of these items are. It's also to maintain our equipment. So it's equipment and maintenance of the equipment.
So does everybody want to start at the highway and go? Okay. Go through. Charlie, go ahead.
Okay, line 189. I know what you want to do, all the stop signs in 1 year.
Yeah, there's 30 stop signs. And actually, if you look around town, most of our stop signs are not reflective.
Most towns don't have them reflective.
Yes, they are. Now, there's two different style reflective signs. Now, you don't have to have the height, but you should have a reflective sign. When you're pulling up to it at night, your lights should be seeing the stop sign.
So there is a USDOT requirement, and you know my contention is just because we can all find a town maybe where you're not always they're not all in compliance. That's not an excuse. The feds can knock it at your door. You can't just say, well, that town over there is not compliant. So we've known for a while that we're not compliant, and so. You know, George talked to us and said, look, if we do all of the stop signs, we can get, we can get a bulk price for the stop signs, and then all of the stop signs will be compliant.
Okay.
So that's the direction.
It's quite a bit of saving by, more than one at a time.
Can I just do a follow-up on that? Okay, so you're going to buy all of the signs. Will there still be enough money left over if you need to replace any other signs?
Yeah, it's $2,000, I think, to get the sign, so it's $500 still in the sign.
Okay.
So just to follow up, one more question on the equipment. What kind of trailer is that? What is the trailer for?
That's for the lawnmower. They're using the heavy trailer for the one that's for the Bobcat. And what they're hauling the trailer is actually not designed to haul the small mower on it. You know, they have to makeshift the ramp to get up on it, which is not safe. And small utility trail. We're actually thinking about pre-treating the roads, and this trailer will also come in use for that. We can put our tank on it in the wintertime and pre-treat prior to storms.
Oh, you're talking about brine.
Our own brine. We're talking about that. We haven't got into that yet. It's in the talking stages, and that's one of the thoughts.
So, one of the things that several of us wanted to make sure the search committee did was to look for people who were willing to go for professional training, professional development, and the like. And George, I'm happy to report, is very enthusiastic about that. And so he and Ed both went to a Green Snow Pro certification training so that you learn to be, I'm not going to say meager, you learn to be adequate with the application of salt. Do you want to say anything more about it? And the brine, and your thought about brine?
Right. We were taught that we could save possibly up to 50% in our salt budget. We bought a road temperature gauge, which we didn't have in town, that we can tell the road temp, knowing when we should be salting, when we shouldn't be salting, how much salt, the class showed us how much salt we should be putting out. Trust we're all calibrated properly for that. And the brine is another way of adding to the savings. In 1 year, they claim at one time 90%. But by the time you buy the equipment to build stuff, you're not going to save. If you can get 50%, you're still quite a savings. So that's why we're looking into building the brine system. And we're going to do it ourselves. We can make, buy the pump and make the equipment ourselves. And use our existing salt to make your brine. So everything is done, with what we have.
Can you just explain to me a little bit about what that is? I know that Dover does it, right?
Right.
Mm-hmm. I've seen it.
Mm-hmm.
But what does it do?
Some towns use a chemical, which is calcium,
calcium chloride.
Or calcium. calcium chloride, and then there's another one, magnesium chloride, that you don't even want to think about doing. The cost of it's crazy, and you'll be driving a car with nothing left of it. What you're actually doing is making salt water with your salt. You pre-treat the road, you'll see that it's a liquid, it's salt, it's basically salt water, at a 23% salination. And you'll notice it's done in lines.
Yeah.
It's done in lines because they don't want to spray the whole road. If that was sprayed completely on your road, uh-huh. and the mixture was wrong, you didn't make a, you're not pre-treating, you're actually icing.
Oh.
The spots between, it's 10 inches between the lines usually, and that is in case the mixture is not adequate.
Okay.
And you wait, make ice, you have a place the dry spots in between, you'll be able to start. Once it starts snowing, the brine is going to spread out. And again, people are asking, why aren't we salting the roads like they used to do with sand all over the place? Mm-hmm. You don't need to. What you need to do is put your salt down the middle of the road and let it roll off. It's once it gets wet, it's going to roll towards the sides. Again, saving unbelievable money. The trucks we have salters that are sanding out the back of the truck. Today's world, most of your salters are out ahead of the front wheel in the middle lane. And if we have to make any changes, that's the hopes of changing the equipment eventually. But we have one truck that they have, I mean, Jeff and Mike Spinney had changed from the rear of the truck to putting it ahead of the wheel. It used to be in the middle of the truck underneath. Salt should be on your center line. It should not be all over the place. You're getting too much of it in the ditch where you're wasting it. And the salting should be done prior to the storm to keep your roads from freezing and touch them as you need it during a storm. You don't need to be spreading salt all the time. Then after the storm, you go out and treat your roads the final time, watching the weather, of course. And that takes, you know, that should take care of it without spreading salt while you're plowing. Or, I mean, you use the salt on the truck for weight. You hit a, you know, you get a hill or something that you're going to need traction on, you hit it, you know, then just maintain it that way. Pre-treating, it gives you that heads up. You know, you can actually pre-treat 2 days before the storm. It's like on a Friday, you got a storm coming on Sunday. It's not used to pre-treat for freezing rain predictions. It's for snow. But that's, you know, and we're hoping to make a system to be able to do that ourselves.
Yeah, but Denise has a follow-up.
So you answered one of them, but once you have a storm come, you wouldn't pre-treat anymore. You would be...
Right, you don't go to brine.
It's ahead of the storm, not during the storm.
Correct. You don't use brine during the storm. That's a pre-treat.
Okay. Thank you.
Just how does the cold weather affect that for initial...
Salt will not work below 15 degrees.
With the brine?
Road temperature, no. You'll get a little bit more out of the brine, but you're not going to get that much more. You can also pre-treat at the truck with the brine. Yeah. Again, it's another cost. You build the tank on the truck and have it drip spreading onto the spinner on the back of the truck. So it's treating it, wetting the salt, and then it pulls it down, which gives it a quicker reaction. You know, that's another way of doing it, but then you can buy your trucks that way or have them put on afterwards, another additional cost. We're hoping to be able to do it to pre-treat, gain a little bit that way, yeah. and then look into other ways as, you know, as we see fit to try to get it down to where we should be.
Now, you don't have any more sand. It's all salt, all right?
Why sand and salt. The sand and salt mix that we're supplying to the public use, and we put a bin in front of the transfer station sign for anyone to use. Yeah. And we're going to maintain that for as it's needed. It's for people with 5-gallon pails or totes. It's not designed to have people go in the pickup truck.
Thank you for joining us.
Yeah.
So, but you don't have any sand in the regular roads. So.
No.
That's separate. Okay.
No, the sand that we can have, you know,
it's just for the public.
And Charlie and then Suzanne.
Okay, line 195. That's the salt.
Yep.
You're saying we're going to save salt. How come we're level funding it?
Suzanne?
That was what I was going to comment on. So, the salt budget was $25,000 for FY17, and we spent, I think, $28,600. So we've overspent it this year.
Right.
By that, and we may probably need to buy some before the year is out. I'm not sure. We'll see how it goes. So the salt price has declined a little bit. So you can see the history in that line.
Yeah.
So we got a, we caught a break there. The truth is, when we built this budget, that these are all new, you know, these are all new developments with George on board and with the brining and that sort of thing. So that's a possibility for some savings, but we don't know how much. We'll have to see. We need some experience in that line. So that's the.
Because I think last year we oversalted. That's for sure. We salted every time we went out.
In July.
Ken, so I see you reduced the tree maintenance line item. What is your plan for that? I see you basically cut it in half. But, so what is the plan for that?
Tree maintenance.
191.
Yeah. We're actually going to be doing it shortly. That was the last year's. And public service has done us a favor. Since the ice storm has done a major job in tree service in town, we can do some of the tree service ourselves. You know, and we're not going to, I mean, if it be cut, we may require having to have a truck and stuff, so, I mean, it should be able to be reduced. Of course, before anything gets cut, we're going to be checking the homeowners and stuff. But, I mean, we're going to do the, you know, the ones that hang over the road if they're low enough to hit vehicles when there's snow on them and stuff. That's stuff we can do ourselves.
So was that a contracted cost before?
I did not answer that question.
So, yeah, so we have, I think, customarily maybe around $5,000 in a tree maintenance line, and we increased it to $10,000 for 2017 because we had, you know, we had a report of, like, I think it was 60 to 70 or 80 dead trees along the roadside. And so with the $10,000 from last year, we were hoping to make a dent in that. With the, you know, the road agent, you know, we had a purchase order. We asked the road agent to hold off because we were concerned about our overall spending last winter, and so we wanted to wait until later in the fall, and then he wasn't here, and George came on board, and then we had that storm, and as George said, Eversource, or, you know, Public Utility, got rid of some of the trees. So we're not sure. We haven't done an assessment of what of those 70 to 80 dead trees still remain, but there is, you know, we have a purchase order out on our 2017 funds that will happen in early January with Urban Tree, and then we'll have to take stock. But we thought we could reduce it to $5,000.
How much is that purchase order?
The purchase order that's out right now?
$3,900.
How much?
$3,900. And that's for work to be done?
Correct. Yeah, he was scheduled because of course this winter storm has got them behind. And he's coming in on the 12th of January to take care of the stuff on Sligo Road that has to be removed.
I was sort of under the impression you had a specific inventory of
trees
that were marked.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And we can't drive around town and say it's gone or it's already fallen over or this one has to be taken out so that we know how many trees we have to deal with?
We just haven't done that. So, yes, it is knowable. It's knowable. But, you know, we know that we're going to have Urban Tree come here and do the Sligo Road trees. And then we'll take stock. I mean, we haven't done that yet, but we will. It is knowable. It's not going to be, are you afraid that maybe we've over-budgeted that line?
No, I'm concerned that they're here and it's urban, they're tree trimmers and it's like, let's do $3,900 worth of business.
Oh no, those trees are marked. We know what he's doing for $3,900. That's not a wild goose chase.
That's not wild. And actually, we're going to be with him. We're going to use eye chipper and get more done for our buck.
Mm.
Yeah. Yes.
I'm sorry.
Can I have copies for free?
By the way,
there's a small fee.
What's that, sir?
I can tell you, you bought a 2004 Brush Bandit 150 XP. It doesn't say when it was. Oh, it was bought in 2004. Does that sound about right?
That'd be about right.
Okay. It's only 13 years old. Sounds like it'll last another 10 years.
It should.
Since it never got used, it must be in pristine condition.
Okay, any other, Suzanne?
It was used for roadside chipping.
Once in a while. Not much. But anyway.
Any other questions on the highway? Go ahead, Charlie.
Line 205. We just hired a guy, Paul. Ahmed, he's been there for about 6 months, I believe. And Ahmed's been there for a year and a half or two. Why they ain't going to be making the same amount of money in the proposed budget? They're both going to be making $11, going from $10.50 to $11, and going to $10.71 to $11.
Are you into the dump, the transfer station?
Yeah. Oh, is that?
Yeah, but where it's still on highway.
Oh, because that was highway.
I mean, do you want to respond
sure.
to that?
It was a recommendation made to us by the, who was then the head of the transfer station at the time, by Russell. Russell said, you know, we need to increase the minimum. So we brought them sort of up to the new minimum, both, of $11 an hour.
Okay.
Best way to
start. I figured that was it, but I just want to know why.
Not because they do a great job. All of our attendants do a great job, so it wasn't a American, it's just trying to get them all up to at least some minimum that seemed to make sense.
He was into sanitation 205.
He jumped ahead.
205.
That's all right. And are there any other highway questions?
Kim's?
Oh. Looking. Hold on. I know, I just have a lot of questions. So I see that that you're proposing eliminating the road war parcel for road maintenance and paving. Is there a reason? What is your reasoning for that? That you don't want it to be a work article?
Accounting simplicity. It's all. I've said this before. Road maintenance to us is road maintenance. We're not unusual. Barrington has it all in their operating budget. Farmington has it all in their operating budget. New Durham has it all in their operating budget. Lee, Durham. Of course, the cities do. They have a different structure altogether. So, there's still some that don't. Madbury does not. We sort of have done what we've been doing.
So just simplicity of?
Simplicity of collecting data, understanding data. I mean, I've been thinking about this and thinking about what the budget committee or some of you on the budget committee, not all of you, are concerned about. And I think what I heard, what I gather is a reluctance or a concern that maybe we would take those dollars and put them somewhere else. So.
Not you necessarily, but I could.
No, and I understand. You want to have your practices and procedures be workable for all situations. But I would nonetheless maintain that even future boards would, I don't know where they would go with that money. The places since I've been here that have had cost overruns have been the highway department and maybe town hall maintenance. You know, those are the places where, so we have our road plan. I'll tell you some more about it if you want me to. We didn't have it updated this year because of two things. The software was being worked on this summer, and it's still not completed. So I don't know what's going to happen there, and then Jeff went away. So, but we're still going to do a 10-year road plan. It may not be in this fancy software that, the UNH folks have developed, but we're going to have a 10-year road plan. So what we're doing is working on the one that we developed first time around. So for 2018 and 2019, the next projects were our two dense developments, the Woodlands and Roberts Pond.
Would you be opposed to putting it in a warrant article? Would you do it kicking and screaming?
Well, what would I put in a warrant article?
$250 for
the project. The project is more than that. I mean, the other thing is, too.
But we've done that before with a warrant article and then supplemented it with dollars.
Yes, and so we've got our accounting in two places. It's not in one place because you spend out the warrant article and then you have stuff in the operating budget.
I'm saying we've done it before where we had a warrant article for
absolutely.
Was it Slagle Bear Road? And it went over. And you had to bring something like $54,000 in from the operating budget to complete it. But that's not a difficult thing to do. What I'm asking, I guess, is would you be adamantly opposed to making it a warrant article? Not just because of convenience and shifting money around, but would you be adamantly opposed?
I'm opposed. I mean, only because of budgeting, how I conceptualize the budget. Road maintenance is an operating expense, and it's there. We will know every year what our projects are, you know, within a range. We have to prove to the state. So should it come to pass, it's hard to imagine, but strange things happen. We have to spend the block grant of money that we receive from the state on road maintenance. So we've got, I think, 100-some-odd thousand this year. And so we can show. So this way we know it's under the board's control. We know we're going to spend that money. And we don't have to worry about the town somehow either saying no or reducing a road warrant or doing whatever might happen at a town meeting.
I've got to follow up to that. Remember the $5 surcharge? On registrations?
Yes.
That's supposed to go in there, isn't it?
No.
It's revenue. It doesn't go
in there. I know, but it's designated by law for road maintenance. Correct.
It is actually a little broader than that. It's sidewalks, I mean, it has a somewhat, but yes, exactly, yeah.
But absolutely. It's in this category.
Absolutely.
Okay, but let's just suppose that the majority of the budget committee said, this really, we'd feel better if this were a warrant article. Would you be adamantly opposed?
No, I'm not the board. I would oppose it. I want it in the operating budget.
Right, okay. And we've got hands flying everywhere. Dennis has been waiting.
My question is, the roads really need a lot of work. They have been years. I'm looking at Sligo Road, which is a lot of the cost. I'm just wondering if the budget committee would recommend would we recommend that warrant article?
So of course, you got to pay the roads.
I know, I'm just saying that.
Just a little interrupting here, that the budget committee would have to vote on something like that, so if we're just getting a general consensus.
No, we need to go up to the deliberations.
Right.
Sort of
that. I mean,
the board is presenting its budget, and this is its budget. The road maintenance is in the operating budget. There is no warrant for resurfacing.
Judy, Denise, and then Ken.
I'm fine. Go on.
You okay?
Yep.
Denise,
quick. So I just want to make the point to Dennis that we can make a recommendation for to do a warrant. It doesn't mean the town will vote to approve it.
Well,
as a separate. It doesn't.
Kim?
The town has always approved it.
Yeah.
What's the point?
I personally think that it should be a separate warrant and that the select board should propose their plan to the voters. So the voters should know what the plan is instead of just kind of dumping it into a line item and it never comes up. Like, there's never any questions about where that money's going. It should be clear and directed funds for a particular piece of work. And not funds that might, not maybe under you, but under somebody else, get kind of distributed throughout the budget. And so I really encourage you to consider making a warrant article. Because remember, it's the budget committee's budget.
Then the budget committee can choose to cut the money out of there. I don't know what to tell you, but it's not a warrant article. But this is the select board's budget proposal. We do not have a warrant article for road maintenance.
Right.
We do need to pay, and what I'm suggesting is you put it, okay, I'll be more direct and less indirect, and that is put it as a warrant article, take it out of the operating budget, and I'm sure that we will support it because the roads have to be made. But make it clear to the voters what this is for.
It is no less clear than it has been in the past. I've read some of the minutes about the road warrants, and they've been, well, we're thinking of doing this, and that, we're thinking of doing, you know. They've been a little vague, and if you follow up the following year, different things may have happened. I think that we are a lot more committed with our road plan, and the problem this year is that it is true, we didn't update it, so therefore we didn't have a public hearing on the road plan. But that's the what the process what is that we started.
So was then to, I think you're on
your
speaker.
I think you're taping yourself.
Oh, okay.
Thank you.
It was a big brother.
Big brother is listening.
Sure.
Go ahead. I didn't mean to interrupt you, but
you know, it's not like we're doing something nefarious or underhanded. You know, New Durham, Barrington, Lee, Farmington. This is standard budgeting practice. It's not some outlandish budgeting practice that we're trying to put in place.
Okay. Go ahead.
Yeah, and I guess if I were doing, I'll put it in a home budget. If I were doing a home budget, I wouldn't take winter snow plowing and put it somewhere off to the side. It would be built into my home budget. And if you're going to do something every year or have the necessity to do something every year, it makes sense to me that it becomes part of your overall budget. So I guess I would ask, turn around and ask your question is, why do you feel so strongly that it needs to be a warrant article?
Kim had a hand up and then run.
So one of the reasons I think is because I think that when it comes down to spending, and we're looking at potentially $1.5 million police department right around the corner, people should be able to kind of pick and choose where they want to spend their money. So if they won't be able to choose one or the other in that case. They may feel that the police department is more important than paving for a year, and they won't have that choice.
That's exactly why it has to be in the operating budget, because we
have
to
give them a choice.
No, we have to spend the money from the state on our road maintenance, or we'll have to give it back to them.
Uh-huh.
That's the point. We have got to spend the money that we get, the block grants from the state, which this year are $100,000+, on road maintenance.
Yeah.
Period.
Well, first of all, the idea of snow plowing is part of your budget. Personal budgets are much more consolidated. This, unfortunately, falls under state law and requires that certain things can be in the operating budget and certain things really should be in warrant articles. And there's more of a tradition. And in the past, this town did do this sort of thing as a warrant article. And I think we should go back to it, because then people clearly understood in a very defined way, not buried inside some very long budget, we're going to pave these roads, and this is why. And if you don't vote for it, the wheels will drop off your car, or the roads will not get paved. I think this is a champion issue, and people should know about it.
I'm good. I would like to add, the roads didn't get paved for a long time. And I think now we're playing catch up to that.
And we should let people know very clearly, this is what we're going to do, and this is what we're going to spend on it.
It's a question. Was it because they were warrant articles and they didn't get approved, or they weren't planned?
That's a good question. It was a little of both, is my perception.
I think we have to have confidence in the voters. They're going to make the right decision, whether it's in the warrant article or not.
I think we've said enough about this. We've made our position clear.
What would you like to do next?
Did we go through the transfer station?
Nope, not yet.
Well, we can start at the top and come back down. Do you want to consider transfer station part of your highway?
Yes, it is. George manages the transfer station as well, so he's here to answer. So my thought is, the highway, transfer station, CIP related, and then George can either stay or go, and then we'll continue the rest.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so
we're going to
move on to
Article
5.
I've already said the highlights of the transfer station, so
mm-hmm.
It's up to you to ask questions.
Nine and ten.
Go ahead, please. On line 208, the uniforms and cleaning. We have more staff, but we're reducing it.
So yes, because there are staff who are choosing not to use the service, so you can't make them. I think the first time they get infested or something, I hate to say it, but something awful happens. Yeah, it's both the highway and the transfer station and in there. I don't know why. It was
will
just
they
a budget
do a
table.
Waiver? I would make them sign a waiver.
I think they did sign one. Yeah.
Okay. Just, you know.
Yeah, I understand. I understand.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Charlie?
Okay, we'll go back to 273. Why do we need a bigger truck? Another plow truck?
You're way ahead.
Yeah, no, that's part of the highway.
Capital?
Yeah.
It's capital.
Well, George is here.
Transfer we're doing the transfer station right now. Then we'll go to the capital projects.
I know, but I thought we were going to get it before George left.
He's here for the transfer station, too.
Yeah.
And capital. And,
he's not leaving.
Well, that's what I thought we were going to.
Can you just break out the attendance, the 7.1 increase in that line item? What percent of that is across the board increase, and what percentage of
take
that
take a look at your deep. There was some. There was a handout of details, budgetary details.
Was it in your packet?
Yes, it was in the packet. It was. I'm just going to steal this right from you.
Go ahead.
Let me
grab
my own
details.
All right, so if you, it looks like this. It's got a lot of blue headers. So if you go to transfer station attendance sort of near the bottom, you'll see the 2018 hourly rate and the number of hours per week, and then just an average that we calculate for brush chipper.
Do we have we now changed the transfer station to be to have somebody there manage it, or are you managing that still?
I'm overlooking it. Russ knows more about the transfer station than I have before dreaming it, knowing it. And he wants to get involved with more recycling and stuff, so let him ride the ball. And
is there a plan to kind of take that off your plate? And,
I don't know. I'm not wanting, you know. That was part of it when I was hired.
No, I mean, our road agent provides general oversight. And Russell, though, has been doing sort of the day-to-day management. We send him to training and the like.
Any other questions for the transfer station? So Dan?
I'm sorry, there are no more questions for the transfer station?
Like
then the capital projects associated with the highway department. So there's the, and George is here again to answer questions on those.
So if you don't mind, I'll let Charlie ask his question since he got halfway through it.
Yeah. Why do we need another plow truck?
It's not actually a plow truck, Charlie. It's a pickup. It's a utility truck.
Yeah,
and we're just putting a plow on it as a backup, as in the past couple of years, apparently you guys have had issues with one truck getting smashed and they ended up having to hire somebody. And then the year before, one of the trucks broke before they bought the new Ford. The plow truck is not going to be used as a plow truck all the time. It's going to be a backup plow. But it will be used in a case where we, you know, if we have a chance, other things to do, you know, get another truck out to help out. I'm not going to put somebody in that truck all the time. The truck is basically a utility pickup truck. So we have something to get around with. We're running around with a dump truck right now, which is not costing.
That's why we wanted a small truck, and that's what was passed at the town meeting. They tried to move it up to a plow truck, and it got defeated. That's why.
A two-wheel drive pickup truck in this business is really not what we need. And it's not something that just we're going to go chase parts with. This is the truck that we're going to use at day-to-day use, running around with, having our equipment with us. To, you know, if we need a saw or something, we have it with us instead of having to run back and forth to the shop. But we didn't have the opportunity of doing that stuff in the dump truck. I mean, running around, like I said, running around with a dump truck is...
No, that's what I thought the little truck was going to be for.
Suzanne?
Yes?
Were you waiting?
Oh, I no, other than, you know, the board, I can just give you some background on the history of this service truck. I mean, the board was a little chagrined, I think, after town meeting, when there was some talk of turning this truck into something other than what had originally been thought. And so we were reluctant to act on it, and again, we weren't sure how our particular, particularly the culverts project, how they were going to come out, so we didn't want to do anything right away, and we put off some of these capital projects until we had a firmer idea. And then Jeff left, so that you know, effectively jettisoned the idea, really, of doing that small service truck. But once we hired George, as he just said, you know, he and Ed, both of them or one of them, will be able to go around, there'll be a utility body on it, they can bring their tools, they can haul a small trailer, but even the $20,000 that we had budgeted was not going to be sufficient for a small two-wheel drive with the state contract. It was going to be closer to $24,000. So this is now probably closer to $30,000.
Can it wait a year? Can we put the money aside and get it a year later?
I believe the truck needs to be bought. Now, like I said, when we go on a project, we have three people, we can't go together unless we take two dump trucks. Again, adding to the cost of running around. I mean, and when we do have to go after parts, we're not going to run around with them, go up with a dump truck to get parts. You know,
this is going to be a crew cab.
No, I don't want a crew cab pickup. I'm not looking to get a Cadillac. I just want a four-wheel drive truck with a utility body and a plow. As a service truck. A crew cab truck, we don't have enough staff to warrant a crew cab pickup truck. We need to bring two trucks. Because you're going to need a dump truck on the job site. But you also need your tools. So having the tools in the truck, we can have a paving, paint, everything we need with us in the utility truck. We need the gravel and stuff to get to where we're going to do these jobs with the dump truck. So you still need that second truck. And then when you're doing chipping, you know, it's nice to have that second vehicle with you to carry your saws and stuff instead of having it in the back of the dump truck, you know, and where the chips are going.
My point on the postponement is that this is coming out of the CIP reserve fund, so there's no hit on taxation. And so if we don't do it this year and don't spend the funds, there's no change to taxation. It's just the bottom line.
Well, you have to make a contribution to SIP, so there is an impact on taxes. It's just that's a particular item in there.
But it's going to be on the CIP, whether we buy it this year or next year, so it doesn't change our contribution. So now it doesn't change our contribution. Our contribution is based on the funding that you see with the CIP.
I'm looking at it.
Dennis?
I don't know what really happened, but we did appropriate the money last year to buy a truck. What happened to that?
That money is still there.
The money's still there, and I thought I'd said this. There was, you know, when we started talking to Jeff, it turned out to be something other than what we had in mind, and so the board wasn't ready to do that, and we were concerned about the culvert project that hadn't started yet. You know, we've been doing engineering and stuff like that, but the actual construction, and so we said, let's put this, we put off the command vehicle, we put off the highway department service truck until we had a clearer idea that we were going to come in under budget for the culverts project, which we did. So that's why we didn't act on it. We knew that there was some, you know, I'll say general confusion about what we were trying to do. George came in, has a clear idea of what he wants to do, what he thinks can, you know, how this can help. And we can always use the snowplow too for things like parking lots and that sort of thing. So
there's already $22,000
yes.
in that.
$20,000 in there. We're looking for $22,000.
I think, can we enact?
I'm just confused about what you call the dump truck. Is that the top kick?
The Ford 550.
Okay. And that's just a regular Ford truck with a dump on it, right?
Correct. It's 10 and a half. It's bigger than a pickup.
550?
It's
550.
And what was the reason that we don't want to use that?
For everyday use?
Yeah.
Fuel, for one thing, it's not cost effective.
What's the payback on that?
On what?
on the use of fuel versus buying a $42,000 truck?
Well, I don't mean I didn't get into that. I mean, as far as the use of
how many miles on it?
Right now?
Yeah.
It's 24,000.
Yeah, I wouldn't worry about the mileage. I'd worry about the hours.
Right. And again, I'm not looking to buy a diesel because that's not cost effective. On the pickups, but highly recommended by every department around here not to go with a diesel because of the cost of maintenance and the fuel prices are about even right now. And the longevity on the gas jobs is almost gone. They're having a lot better luck with the gas jobs than they are with the diesels.
Mm-hmm. Hard test.
Which is another $10,000 difference.
Is it a VA? A VA?
Yeah, it would be a VA.
So it'd be high test gas.
No, it was still running record.
Once you get the other thing, you don't need a test anymore.
Ken was in the middle of a question.
I'm just wondering, is there really a that significant of a difference in gas mileage between the two trucks?
Oh, it should, yes. I mean, significant, it probably won't be, it might be 5 miles a gallon. But, I mean, the use for the truck, having the enclosed compartments, to have your tools with you, and not having to have everything in the back of the truck, like when you're going out shipping, you've got a trip box on the back of the truck, so your tires and stuff are, what I'm trying to say is, I guess, is it's what what we need. More than, then if you're going to go for chase parts, running up the road with a dual wheel pickup truck, wearing out 6 tires versus 2 tires, and if you want to really get into all that stuff, and wear and tear on a vehicle, a pickup truck is a lot more useful for day-to-day activities if we don't need a dump truck with us.
Truck tires are really expensive,
though. Car tires are expensive.
Compared to
I bought a few in my time.
Yeah.
They are expensive. Mm-hmm. And they're really hard to mow.
The roadside mowing attachment, what is that going to be attached to?
The skid steer Bobcat that we have. And again, with the roadside mower, the payback in that would be, I guess they had $4,500 set aside for roadside mowing, and they haven't been able to find somebody to do it anymore because of the guy that was doing it gave up because his equipment was gone. Mm-hmm. It cost prohibitive for him to fix it. Mm-hmm. And we had a second guy lined up, and his machine blew the motor before they got a chance to do it. So by doing it, buying our own, we can do roadside mowing everywhere in town as we need it instead of certain amounts every year with the amount of money you're allocating. And it can be done maybe twice a year instead of having it done once a year if we have the equipment sitting in-house.
We don't have one now.
No, not at all. And utilizing the piece of equipment we have to put it on is a saving in itself.
Do you want to talk about the CIP, Suzanne?
Well, are we done with highway transfer and CIP related to highway?
I don't know. All right, then
how I would like to attack this is with, So, sort of like what we would do, and I don't know why we've lost the production anyway, sort of like what we would do when we sat with the board working on this, is to look at our big picture first. So if you take a look at the spending projections, 10-year spending projections, so 2018, of course, is the period that we're projecting, The first line is the operating budget, so that ties in with the bottom line of the operating budget that you have in your possession.
Long-term financing ties in with the long-term financing requirement, $79,730. So that's the next year, 2018, when we start paying back on our bonds and loan from the USDA. And there is a payback schedule in the material that I handed out, so you can see what the terms and conditions of our loans were. They did come in. We borrowed less money than we thought we were going to need. And our last year, when we did our 10-year spending projections, the loan payback that we were projecting to start in 2018 was $110,000. So this is $30,000 less. It's just under $800,000, and it will go down for the first 15 years steadily. And then the next 15 to 30 is just the USDA loan, and that's a fixed term. I think it's like $17,000-something. But you can see it in the loan, the loan terms that you have down. So that's where that line comes from. Then the annual request for the Capital Improvement Reserve Fund, we're asking for $178,200. That is a warrant article. There is nothing in reval for this year, but if you go look at the 10-year projections, we're going to start the cycle next year, a five-year cycle of asking for money. We are asking for $10,000 for a culvert fund warrant article to help us with Sligo Road culverts. And then I said last year that when we did our 10-year projections, we were going to start to include revenue in the line. So here it is. This is the revenue that we're anticipating exclusive of reserve funds. So that gives us a tax effort this year. So that's the amount of money that we are going to have to cover with our tax rate for the town budget of $901,019, which is, you know, about $5,000 less than last year. And so where our municipal tax rate was $3.24 this year, we're anticipating it to be $3.22 next year. That's the big picture. And now I also have highlights, which fortunately I've been involved in an administrative project, so I didn't get to it today, and I didn't get to spend as much time, but I did send this out by email earlier today, and I think Michelle maybe did as well. So these are, I'm going to walk you through some of the highlights, and then we'll go through the budget, however, at whatever level of detail you would want. So again, it's a little bit better than a $5,000 decrease in our tax record, or the projected 2-cent decrease. And we are projecting to keep the tax effort within a 2% increase for 2019 through 2021. And if you look at the projections, you can say, well, no, you've got 2.1, 2.1, 2.5. And while that's true, we're well within striking distance. I mean, this is what it looks like right now. It's just, you know, inflators and this and that. But we're well within striking distance. In order to get it down, for example, to 2 from 2.18, it's a decrease of $1,600 in that budget. So, you know, the board feels committed to, and feels that we can, through the 2021, that we can keep it within a 2% increase. That's absent a police station. That does change the calculus. So this is just, as we're seeing things right now. So we're anticipating increased revenues for motor vehicles, the state supplemental highway block grant, police detail, and about $135,000 in grants. I've talked about the payback on our loans. So we had been authorized to borrow $1.02 million. We ended up borrowing almost $885,000. And our projected annual repayment is about $30,000 less than we were projecting. So what are some of the significant changes in the overall budget? We've already mentioned to you the highway, so the full-time highway department assistant. We have three elections in 2018 as opposed to one in 2017. So that doesn't have a major impact on the budget except for the programming for the voting machine. There was a 6.1% decrease in health insurance premiums. But overall, you'll see a small increase in that line. And if you remember, we've consolidated them all into one line. There's an overall small increase because we have an additional full-time employee who's on health insurance. But we would otherwise have seen a decrease in that line. There was an increase of 1 hour a week for our building inspector. The highway department, you know, we're expecting to keep more jobs in-house. The road plan, I've already said, we're concentrating in the next 2 years on Roberts Farm and the Woodlands. We'll complete one this year and then and do as much as we can of the other one, and then we'll finish the other one next year. Transfer station decrease in hauling costs. There's a decrease in welfare. You know, we've just not been using our welfare line out pretty consistently for the last 5 years. So we decreased it by, I think, 5,000. And then budgetary bookkeeping. All the road maintenance projects are subsumed into the operating budget. Health and other personnel-related coverage is consolidated in the personnel administration section. Salaries are displayed as department head, full-time, part-time. And we are maintaining a line, this is a new line in personnel administration that we're actually funding it. I think there may have been one last year, but we're going to use it for termination payments for people who leave and for health insurance adjustments. If somebody goes from single to a two-person to a family or single to a family, so we'll use that line to help fund that.
Actually, I think it's always been an issue with larger organizations that you accrue and set aside for accrued leave, sick leave, comp time,
correct,
and so forth, so that you don't get stung,
correct,
when someone leaves.
And we haven't done that.
Are you going to?
Well, we at least are maintaining it in an operating budget line. So this is the line,
yes,
that we'll use for that sort of thing. So we don't have a balance sheet account that has that, if that's what you're asking.
There's no liability account for that?
No. So it's our own internal life, you know, look, we need to pay attention to it.
Ken, did you have a question?
I did. On the financing, so I understand it, the years 2033 through 46, you have culverts at 246.9. That's a one-time payment.
No.
That's every year.
No.
So
that's
I just didn't put each year because it was the same.
I see.
Do you see what I did? So we're going to owe until 2046. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And the payments are unvarying from 2033 to 2046. So however many lines or however many years are in there, I just multiply that by 17,640.
Gotcha.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, is that principal or principal and interest?
That's everything. That's principal and interest.
So 30 years. How many years is that?
The culverts are 30 year and they're fixed. But they don't have any payback penalty. So if the town chooses at some point to pay back more than the 17,640, we can. Whereas the bonds are fixed.
Wait. USDA, you can prepay?
Yeah, they would prefer, actually, because it releases the money to be used for another municipality.
So they don't consider it a bond?
It's not a bond. No, it's a loan. USDA is a loan. Sorry. We have bonds for the fire engine and the transfer station project. USDA is a loan.
What did we spend on paving for the transfer station?
130 maybe. Compactor, 20 plus another 5, I think, for electricity and other associated things. We did the gate.
So we'll probably be paying. We'll still be paying for it when we have to do it again.
The paving?
Yeah.
Well, so, however, the people who issued the bond know what we're doing. They knew exactly what the project entailed, and they make sure that the life, the term of the stuff that you're doing has to be within that. So, or they won't issue it. So they have a life expectancy of 10 years on everything that we did at the transfer station. A life expectancy of, you know, at least 10 years on that. A life expectancy of at least 15 years for the fire engine. And a life expectancy of at least 30 years on the culverts.
It's kind of like leasing. You never stop paying.
No. No.
Well, after 10 years, I mean, we'll have to pay it again. We've just done
paying for the paving.
Oh.
Or we don't get.
Well, you know when you buy a car and it lasts for 6 years and you have to buy another one? Yeah, same thing.
That's the same.
No, and buying it.
All right, so let me go back to the highlights. I'm sorry, I lost my...
Your question is open too.
Okay, there we go. So, some of the things that we're thinking of doing in 2018 that will have projected planning efforts for the future. Not necessarily for 2018. We're hoping to have a group look at providing adequate workday coverage for the fire department. And then we're also looking at a town administrator and then a bookkeeper. So in other words, increasing administrative services for the town. Road infrastructure / engineering, we're gonna be looking. So after we manage the developments, the Roberts Farm and Woodlands. The village is one of the next items on our list. And the village has stormwater implications. We have storm drains that are not in good shape. We have places where there aren't storm drains, there should be storm drains. So we're preparing to work on the village and repave it. We're going to be perhaps hiring some engineering help for stormwater related issues, so we know where to put storm drains and we know how best to fix storm drains, etc. So that's a planning project that we're anticipating doing next year. Building infrastructure, the police station, there's been a committee working on the police station. We did issue an RFP in November. Other than issuing the RFP, there's been no mechanism. I don't think we're going for a bond in March, is kind of like what I'm trying to say. So I think what we'll do is spend next year, you know, laying down the groundwork, doing a project plan. If we were to do the police station, what do we do with the downstairs space? What does it do for maintenance in this building? How does it increase overall maintenance by having another building and the police station? So all of those things, you know, it's not just, oh, let's put up a building and here's what it's going to cost us. You need to figure out some of these other pieces that have some significance. So I personally don't feel we're ready to go for a bond this March. So,
have time.
Precisely. So we can use next year, though, to be better prepared so that when it does come before the voters, we've got a lot of these issues projected, the projected cost for some of these items. Some of the other things that we'll be spending our time on is the potential dissolution of the Lamprey Regional Cooperative Trucking Cooperative. So we have a 10-year contract with Lamprey Regional Co-op that allows us to bring our stuff to Turnkey Landfill. But we also started how many towns, can I ask Jody to answer? How many towns in the little trucking co-op again?
Five
of us. So we've been managing this for, actually I don't know how many years, it predates me. And we've had issues with the truck and the driver and the truck and back and forth. And we tried to get out of it last year. I tried to get out of it. We at least wanted to know what it would cost us to get out of it. Because we thought we could do better by getting quotes for hauling rather than paying mileage for the truck to go from Lee to here to Turnkey, back to here, then back to Lee. So we are now not the only town that's thinking that this isn't the best mechanism for us to manage the hauling of our municipal solid waste. So next year we may be planning on the dissolution of that piece of it. And then, you know, there probably isn't time, but it's always interesting to me to think about doing something with energy performance. So those are some planning projects that are coming up. Upside potential, I didn't really have time to spend a whole lot of time. I know that from a revenue perspective, both the hydro revenue and the police detail could generate more revenue. We've got a new operator for the hydro plant, and yes, this is Green Mountain in Vermont. And they, when they
made their own financial plans of their investors and whatnot about the anticipated revenue. They're anticipating revenue of $55,100. And I called when I saw that figure because, hello, we haven't gotten that in a long, long time. So I said, how are you anticipating generating more electricity? And he says, well, not necessarily, he said, but we're regulated. And so while I don't understand the nuances, apparently he can sell it for more than these could sell it for. So I said, okay, well, I appreciate that. I'm really not going to use that $55,100 figure because it scares me. So what we did, we increased it by 7,000. So we increased it to 42 or something. So it could, you know, there could be an upside potential. Also, police detail if in fact the police work the detail, if we have budgeted an expense side, we will generate more revenue than what we're anticipating in the revenue budget. What are some of our downside risks, worries, and concerns? We have our mid-sized plow truck, not the dump truck that George has been talking about. GMC Topkick? It has never been right-sized for the job. It was sort of meant to be driven by that kind of truck is probably best operated by someone with a CDL, but we didn't have a person with a CDL at the time, and so they made some adjustments to that truck so that it could be driven by somebody without a CDL, but it doesn't help for its longstandingness. George, would you like
now
to?
I got a time. A CDL is a certain gross vehicle weight.
Over 26,000.
And what did they do? Chop off a bunch of the truck?
No, what they did is they bought a small truck and built it up close to that CDL weight to do the job that they need to do with it. Mm-hmm. However, the truck is not big enough to handle a wing and a plow properly and put a big sander on it. The truck is being overused for the size.
Overweighted.
Over, yeah.
It's not over the CDL limit.
No, it's not. Well,
it's close to it.
Not on the door rating, it's not on the CDL rating. But when you throw a sander in the back of it, and then you load that sander with sand, and you put a wing and a plow on it,
it's over.
The truck does not have air brakes. The truck has standard brakes. The truck is too small to do the job. They're killing the truck, basically what's happening to it. It's underpowered. And it's a two-wheel drive.
It should be on the inventory.
You know, it's not a...
Or the CIP.
They could have got a smaller truck with four-wheel drive and done the same job with a little bit more power.
This is the GMC?
Yes.
6,500?
Yeah.
Two thousand seven.
Right. 2008 model year.
Dennis?
All right, can we sell the truck right now?
Absolutely, that truck is worth, it's probably worth more.
And get something that's, can we do that?
And after looking at the roads here, we won't need another big dump truck. A smaller dump truck can handle, the roads aren't big enough
so
to
we don't
put
need
a big dump truck. You need one big dump truck so you can have it for hauling and stuff, and then pushing the snow back after the storm. But most of your roads, that big dump truck can't plow properly because it's too big.
You know, when you sell it, you sell it.
Hang on, Dennis is tough.
When you sell it, you sell the sander and the plow with it?
I would get rid of everything that's with that. That's
so
the plow has been, they just had to rebuild most of the plow on it this year because...
How old is it?
It's 2008.
It's more than 2007.
And apparently when they had it built, that truck had come with smaller tires, and apparently at DePrizio's, they put the bigger truck tires on it to make it like a big truck.
Yeah.
And it's costing you now. This isn't from me. This is from Sam, the head mechanic at Dover Highway Department. And he's saying, and I've driven the truck. The truck gets around nice. However, it doesn't have the power to keep going. That was in... originally be replaced this year. I want to see what it would do. And we could probably get another couple of years. But I tell you right now, we don't need to be buying another big truck.
No,
so we can get another useful, smaller truck before this one actually dies.
No, well, let's get rid of it.
I just wanted to clarify one thing. When George saw the CIP, he saw it originally for us to buy it in 2018, but that was not what it was last year. It's what we did when we started hearing these tales about the truck. We said, oh my God, we're going to have to replace it right away. And then when George came and started thinking about it, he says, I think we can do it. It's on the CIP for 2019, I think.
It is,
right? Yeah, 2019. And so that price, I think it's there, is $190,000.
Mm-hmm.
That will likely come down when we do the CIP review next year. But it, you know, you have to put a stop to these things. So I mean, we were beyond the time when we were messing with the CIP when this came down. So, but next year when we do the review, it will, that price will likely go down based on what George just said. All right. So back to Lori.
Did you have a follow-up
on this? No, I was going to ask a question about a fire truck. How far down the road do we have to go before we place the next fire?
You know, that's a really good question. And the CLP did not come back with that a fire truck replacement. The board asked them to do so. So I don't know exactly what the story is there, but we need to put that truck on the CIP so that we know when to plan for.
We don't need to do what we did for the last fire truck, you know.
Right, to have everything
right,
exactly.
Yeah.
So we're trying to plan for it.
I seem to recall the chief saying it's 20 years and then you have to replace your fire truck.
The second
standard that every 20 years you have to replace your fire truck. Now that may be just him commenting.
That's right. That's in today's world, but 15. Trucks are not lasting what they used to last, and you're paying three times what you used to pay.
The CIP is. We need to get the fire truck on the CIP.
I was on the CIP. And it was requested, but it didn't happen by the department head. So.
Yeah, so what can you do? Exactly.
Right.
So we've been requesting it, and next year we'll try the same thing. We will get it on there next year.
I hope the fire truck lasts 15 years because we won't be done paying for it.
No, not this one.
No, this is the new
one. This is the other one.
The other truck. I'm talking about even the new one.
Let's put your retirement schedule.
Okay, line six. Is Caroline getting 2% this year?
Yes.
Okay, and I have another question referring to Caroline. If the town hall is open
16 to 20 hours a week, and she's working 32. Is she working alone in this building at times?
Yes, but locked. If it's the town office isn't open officially, she will lock the door. Just for safety reasons.
No, I understand the safety reason. Yes. My question is, does she check with anybody to say she's leaving the building so that people know she's not here, since it's locked?
I'm not sure I understand.
Okay, if she's working here alone and it's locked,
yes.
My question is, does she tell anybody she's leaving the building? Because if it's locked, nobody will know if she's here or not. Just for a safety issue.
Who's she going to tell if she's alone?
She could call the police.
There's a panic button. We have a panic button that's at her desk. I guess I don't know how to answer that. She hasn't raised that issue. I mean, you know, I've been here alone myself.
Yeah,
you know, it can be a little unsettling, and I will keep that door locked myself.
I don't blame you for locking.
So that's how she manages it.
But she does have a panic button.
There is, yeah.
She can't get the panic button.
Well, listen, even if you get to the panic button, we have one officer on duty, so if she, he is all the way across somewhere, you know, it's going to take a while. I mean, it's not the best thing, but it's better than nothing.
Thank you. That answered that.
Okay. So I don't understand. It says 6.5% increase in that line item. What can you explain how that?
Yes, absolutely. So we increased her hours to 32 as of April 1. So last year the budget was billed for 3/4 of it working 32, and this year it's the full budget.
Last year she was already at like 34
hours a week.
No.
The increase is adding 3 more months in FY18 because last year it was only 9 months.
At the new rate.
At the same rate, plus the 2%.
How many hours a week was she working last year?
At the beginning of the year, it was 29.75.
I thought it was like 30.
No. That would have made her full time. So we were weaseling. It was not something we were proud of, but we kept her under the full-time hourly rate. And so in 2017, we increased her hours to 32, making her full time, but only starting April. So it was just 3/4 of a year.
Okay, I'll follow up. Yeah. I guess my question is, so that salary has almost doubled in 5 years. How has that job changed? It used to be 21,000, now we're almost at 40.
Yep, so we weren't keeping up. We're not keeping up now, we're not keeping up then. There's more to the administrative burden no matter where you look. We have more reporting to do, whether it's an MS4 reporting, whether it's reporting now for the grants that we receive, whether it's reporting on our loans and certifying that we've got this policy and that policy. We've instituted policies that we've had to institute in order to get some of these loans. And so they have to be followed up with every year, like conflict of interest. We need to touch base with all of our employees once a year to ensure that they are following the conflict of interest and to let us know if there is a conflict. We have to promulgate the drug-free policy every year. Our particular administrative assistant also manages welfare, which was brand new, which was a new function, and she's done a really wonderful job, as you can see from the decreased, with that consistent administration of that function, she's able to, keep the costs down because she's on these people every week. You know, she gives them what they have to do, they have to follow this, they have to do that, and she follows up with all of that. So welfare is another piece.
So you have a job description?
We're in the process of doing job descriptions.
So there's no way to know where we were and where we are today?
Certainly no way to know where we were. There was no job descriptions when I got here. So I'm happy to show you later on, too, the towns. We're in the minority as far as towns that do not have a town administrator. If you look at either Stratford County, if you look at towns with a population within 2,000 to 3,000, which is us, if you look at towns that have in our general valuation, most of them have town administrators, town managers. Some of them have town administrators with other personnel, not just a town administrator. So it's not, I understand that it's really different for us, but it's not unusual if you look around. We have been under-resourced, and we've managed because we've had a select board that has, you know, had some people who spent, were able to spend practically full time. But that's not the job, that's not what a select board is normally expected to do. It's not what select boards do in surrounding towns. And so, you know, if we were to lose our administrative assistant, we lose a whole lot of institutional knowledge. And because that, that gets, you know, overturned every year with the select board, you know, especially, you know, if, you know, it was unusual for us to have the sort of long-term, long-serving members that we had.
We survived the loss of Deb. You know, she had 25 some odd years.
Are we paying for all the classes now? That,
no.
Hoping that she will be paying around.
No, no.
No?
No.
No.
We don't. She's paying for them.
Okay.
Okay. Line 11, Budget Committee Communications.
Yes. So we moved that $300 in consolidated printing and copying.
And the reason for that is?
After chatting with the Municipal Association, I think I mentioned this to the Budget Committee. So the board manages the communications to the public. The Budget Committee manages the communications by recommending, not recommending, preparing the budget. You know, we, you know, the town will do, you know, printed copies that whatever that the Budget Committee needs.
Okay, my question was, is because it was $79 spent this year out of the communication line.
Yes.
So we must have, someone, the Budget Committee must have spent money somewhere.
Signs.
Yes,
okay.
Signs.
So there won't be any money for signs?
No, I didn't say that.
Okay. Well, that's why I was asking.
The town will be doing signs.
Okay.
Okay, line 20, professional service. You've gone down 7,500. You're not expecting any problems?
So if you take a look at the additional details for specific lines,
mm-hmm.
So you'll see professional services is at the bottom of page one. And so these are, you know, they're not cast in stone, but these are our projections, what we're going to use professional services for. So welfare review remains on the list, because while we get closer to the list, we haven't done it yet. We're really close with an MOA of Oak Street. We've been doing an annual winter memorandum of agreement with Dover, but we need an overall memorandum of agreement that talks about the road maintenance as well, and non-winter. We've got 5,000 to deal with compliance issues that we're dying to try to deal with that we have not yet been able to manage. Cell tower lease, you know, there may be an opportunity to increase revenue from the cell tower with different revenue, a different way to manage the revenue. And so we have been asking Steve Roberts and his firm to look at that. The FERC hydro relicensing, we're not anticipating big expenditures there, but in case we do something with the 500. And then just a general 2,000 for dealing with bed bugs or whatever else comes up that we never know will happen.
The reason why I brought that up, follow up, is we still got that problem on Rollins Road, and we still got the problem on Clement. You don't expect any legal from that?
Yeah,
or
that's
problems.
The compliance line,
okay.
$5,000 line, Charlie.
Okay.
Yep. And then from an engineering point of view, you know, it's some combination of maybe some engineering help with Sligo Road culverts. George has some ideas on the culvert, and so, you know, I think we're going to ask him to sit with our engineers and the board to talk about that. And again, you know, we know in, I think, 2020 we're going to be looking at making changes of paving in the village, and so we want to position ourselves so that if we have some storm drain work to do, that gets done either before or certainly as part of that project. So that's the professional services.
I can start on the elections and registrations. So this is the part that Kate was sorry she couldn't be here tonight to present. Really, the significant change is, it's not a change. We weren't anticipating doing another voting booth, but she said it really worked out well, and she would like to get another voting booth, which will just make voting a faster process and cut down on the lines during those times when they back up. So that's $700. And then the other thing that probably bears some conversation is the town clerk info systems, line 40. So we do have an annual maintenance fee. It's probably half of that $645. So we are a year ahead in the payment is the issue. And so we're not going to have to pay a maintenance fee in 2018. And the following year, it will show up as $375 or whatever.
Wasn't this the one?
Charlie had his hand up.
I'll get back to the voting booth. Is there enough privacy with that screen? You know, you can't
it's
go
a very, yeah. It's a very common approach.
Yeah.
That, you know, and we still have the,
yeah.
the if somebody really would like to go into the curtain one, that it will be available. But it's very much de rigueur. It's what is being used in voting. So we had no complaints.
So follow up. It was budgeted $700 last year. We paid $541, and you budgeted $700 this year?
Yes.
Okay. Why are you staying at the $700? I know it's small stuff, but...
Well, I would say, you know, things don't stay the same.
No, I understand that.
We got that one at a discounted price because it was a demo model, so a demo model may not be available.
Okay. No, that would explain it. It's a small thing, but I have to ask some questions.
There you go. Brian,
go ahead.
The town clerk info system. This was the one that was supposed to be able, you were supposed to be able to do everything online, like register dogs or something.
No.
What was it for? What does it do?
Dog licensing. It helps manage the dog licensing project, so at the close of the day, Kate knows what she has to return to the state. I'm not going to be able to tell you like the precise details, but there are, now it's true that it's also a root module. It is a central module, such that if you were going to do some of those other things, you would need this module. But it was not bought to do that because there's a lot of associated expenses that come with that. It was bought to do dog licensing.
Follow up.
Sure.
So you bought something that had the potential to do all sorts of bells and whistles. But in order to roll out the rest of the bells and whistles, a significant amount of expense would be involved.
Yes. Not only, because we don't only have to buy other modules.
Yes.
But you also have to arrange for ACH, you know, automated clearinghouse. You need an automated clearinghouse process so that you can separate the money that goes for registration
right,
that goes to the state and stays with us. That's expensive. So that's not free. There's an expense with that. So we haven't taken the next step. So it does what we wanted it to do, but we haven't built on it to do some of these other things.
What it sounds like is you bought a very large vehicle and now you don't have tires for it, so you can't use it. It's
no,
an intended purpose.
I wouldn't classify that. It was bought to do dog licensing. That's what it's for, but that module is also necessary for some of the other things.
Well, we'll never be able to use them because of the expenses associated with them.
Back and forth.
Yeah,
But
clear.
That's the follow-up. I mean...
That functionality isn't in that module. It's just that module was built to have some of the other hooks that allow us to...
Yeah.
We don't have those other things.
Well, as long as your mouth is full of faith, I'll ask more questions.
Go ahead, Kim. So there's a new line item here, see for town meeting, according to Secretary Chalker.
Yes.
Somebody's actually going to take notes.
Yeah, they're required to do.
Yeah, they're
okay.
We've got
to
pay Corey.
It used to be
Corey,
the town clerk's job. How does that expense break out?
About half and half.
Okay.
And you can see on line 34, if I can point that out, the additional expense for having the doing the programming for the three elections that we have. So we are responsible for programming the vote counting machine for all elections that we hold. The printing of the ballots, we are only responsible for the printing the ballots for the March town meeting. Mm-hmm. The other elections, the ballots are provided by the state.
Any other questions on page two? Just for the sake of time.
I just have a quick question. I noticed you've been going down through, I'm looking at line 45. I noticed you've been going down through and giving 2% like to the town clerk. And did the treasurer not ask for any more money?
Correct. Nor did the select board, nor did the moderator, nor, I mean, so.
Elected, right?
Well, the fire chief is, the town clerk is elected, and the fire chief is elected.
Yes,
and he was global.
That's what I was just talking about.
Okay, page three.
So you can see in personnel administration that we have health insurance, life and disability, all collected there.
Suzanne, can I just ask a question on the decrease in health?
Yes.
Can I make the assumption it's because somebody less took it? Because your premium, or did your premiums really go down?
No, the premiums actually went down by 6.1%. There was a decrease in premiums. Now, we hired a full-time person, so that there's another person who's being covered. So even with that, it's just a overall, because of the 6.1% decrease, there's an overall increase of only $681.
You have more than one medical plan, I presume. You have like a Primo plan and a Primo plan and then a, what ACA would call goals.
I'm not sure. I know, I think everybody's on the same plan.
Same deductible, same copay, everything?
Yes.
No, okay. Not the same carrier.
Not the same plan. Other than single two-person family, but it's the same plan.
Your carrier wouldn't give you multiple plans?
Well, we had a workshop.
I don't think there's enough people just to have multiple plans. We're too small. We just have one plan. I mean, I don't have enough justification.
We just have one plan. Everybody's on.
We just have one plan. State has one plan.
No, they have one carrier. They
one, plan. One plan. Two choices, but they're the same. It's the same plan, HMO or PPO.
Right, but there's different plans. They're actually different things within the carrier.
No, they only have the one.
Just your provider, if you can pick your own or not, that's all. But the rest of it's the same.
Okay.
I'm sorry, anything else on page three? Page four?
So on the line 84, the heat for town hall, the last couple of years it hasn't gone over 6,000, but you're keeping it at 10. Is there a reason for that?
Well, this is 6,000 only through November, right?
Well, last year was the same. Last year it was 5,158.
So it's going to be more than 5,797 because we get boiled probably more than once a month even. So it will be probably over 6,000.
But it won't be 10,000.
Possibly not, but there's usually, as we're sort of budgeting those things, one facility goes over, another one goes under, so. We did reduce the heat at the highway shed. We increased the fire station and the transfer station.
Any other questions on four? Go ahead, Nancy.
All right, at the transfer station, you increase the heat because of the two sheds, but you're only using one shed at a time, correct?
Yeah, but you have to keep both propane tanks filled, right? So a fill is whatever a fill is.
I'm Charlie and then Ken.
Okay. No, I'll follow up on this. If, even if you got two tanks, so it'd take you twice as long to use two tanks as it would one, wouldn't it? Because you only use one half
sure.
and then go back to the other.
Can I answer that?
Sure.
There's a, the hydraulic systems in them have to run, maintain heat to operate properly. They don't shut the heat off. They've got to maintain heat in both units all the time.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sense.
That makes sense. Because I was, I know that they don't, they're not.
No, no, they're not in the building all the time. But they have to, the units have to be maintained with heat, or else they're not going to run properly, or run at all.
Okay. So, line 87, heat fire station. So last year heat fire station was $30,559. This year it's not four, but you went up to seven.
It was Chief Rutherford. I don't. I don't know. I don't know. Can't. At the time that we did this, it seemed the appropriate amount to use.
Charlie.
Line 92. Town hall repairs. I noticed you've gone down on that. And don't we have a boiler downstairs that's on its last leg?
Yeah, that's a SIP.
Yeah, it's on a SIP.
Yeah.
It's scheduled for
29. It was scheduled for this year. And you moved
it? We moved it. We checked in with Chief Ducharme and we checked in with some other folks. And, you know, we're going to, we didn't know, we don't know how it, what it costs. We know that there's 20,000 in the CIP. We wanted to spend this year to study it.
Okay.
So, but that's, I think it's, one of the things we want to look at.
And I'm going to follow up on that. The back window on the top floor here, you got about 6 to 8 feet that fell off and because it was rotten. Are we going to do anything with that?
The
trim board on the top.
I don't know.
I mentioned it in the summer when you had the crane here, but I know the budget was tight then. I just wanted you to remember that it's still
okay.
up there.
Okay, thank you.
Anything else on page four?
Repair roof shingles since they blew off. Put a net over them.
Michelle, can I thought that was a an what call it comment, but I want to respond to it. So we had a roofing contractor look at the transfer station and highway department.
Yes.
And so the roof, we both have the wrong shingles, and they were applied incorrectly. So they're, and I'm not going to remember the detail, but I mean, so they're apt to, in a windstorm, come off. But nonetheless, the roofer that we had look at it said, you know what, you don't have to replace the whole roof. If there's a wind event and you lose some, replace them. So that's the plan that we're going to do, because and we've got it on the CIP for I don't know what year, but that's the year the roofer suggested we should just then do the whole roof.
I know, but it brought to mind the vision of somebody's out there with a net on a windy day grabbing the shingles as they go by. I'm sorry.
Nancy.
Okay, back to 93. I believe at the last select board meeting you okayed the installation of the loft and everything that was going to be put into the highway, and you still have it in the budget?
Well, all right, so there's just a $500 increase in that, in the repairs and maintenance to the highway shed. So that, you know, the shingles are, who knows, right? How many wind events, how many shingles? So that's an indeterminate origin. So we want to make sure we can cover that. And the other things that we're planning on doing is to repair the drywall that's in the office. Rather than moving it, we had a plan at one point to move the office from the front to the back. You know, George,
doesn't feel that that's necessary, but we do have to replace the drywall. And we want to install an exhaust fan.
Follow up. George, did you do some replacing of some of the drywall already? Oh, no. Okay, it was just a discussion that you had.
Yes, what we did, we actually sealed around the floor to stop the water from going in to damage the drywall. We did, around the office, it's done. We just got to do the bathroom and for them to do that.
Okay.
At a later time. The drywall was just a matter of cutting off the lower section of it and putting those pieces in.
Exactly. I remember at the select board meeting that that was.
Coat of paint there and done it.
Okay, so back to page 5. Any questions there? I'm sorry, I'm just trying to, for time constraints, keep us moving. Page 6.
When you see the police, there should be no
discussion.
Yeah, no change.
Okay. Mm. Page 7 is fire. So
fire,
right there. Go ahead, Ben.
Fire. Have they been doing any deeping? I noticed the outside is still, the front of it is really, looks rough.
He has painting, I think, scheduled for 2018.
Oh, he does. Okay. How's the roof? Did he mention that?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I think it's on the CIP.
It's on the CIP.
It's on the CIP. I can't remember for what year. So it's on the CIP.
Page 8, the highway, which we've done. Going back to page 8, Ken,
Who was our health inspector before?
Sean Glidden.
And how did we pay him?
$500 stipend?
For the year?
Yes.
Okay. So now we're adding $400 a week?
That's not for health. He is now also the health officer, but it's for increased work with code enforcement, building permits, and the like.
How many hours a week is he now?
5.
So he's going to 10?
No. He's at 4, he's going to 5.
I'm going to 5. He's at 4 now.
He's at 4 now, he's going to 5.
Okay.
I'm sorry, Nancy.
That's okay. On that same line, so is he still going to get the stipend when he does health officer work, or is he going to get paid?
No, we moved the stipend into that line to help fund the additional hours. But
so he'll get paid the $80 an hour for the health inspector work?
No.
Okay.
He's consider him salary. He gets paid for what is the equivalent of 5 hours per week. He probably puts in more. Right now it's 4 hours per week.
Did we eliminate the line item for health officer?
Yes.
Fold it in?
It's there, but it doesn't have anything
placeholder.
In it.
A dollar.
Yeah, it's just a placeholder because we may not always have it. Oh, it's down. Okay, let me find it.
It's on first. 226.
Oh, all right.
Okay, so page 9, we did the transfer station. Any comments on street lighting? Is the only thing in there? Yes?
Is there any discussion going to LED street lights?
I would love to.
Nope.
That's part, yeah, I understand. Somebody has to put in the time to make it happen, study it. Is it cost effective to just do that? Should we be doing that as part of a larger energy performance contract? Blah, 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 blah. There's a lot of stuff.
Follow up on that. PSNH. Now Eversource, and said at one time, I talked to them about it, they said, we'll fund the cost of the LED lights. You have to agree to buy the energy from us for a fixed period of time. There was a private group who said, we'll fund the cost of your lights, and there were some other kickers to it, and it came out to be much more expensive.
Well, there were other things in that bag.
Yeah.
Which were also cost of, to provide energy efficiency. But
a more energy efficient boiler. So there were other sorts of things, and you can make the package more attractive by including things that have the faster payback right away, you know, that helps fund it. We can also do it ourselves. We can be disciplined and do it ourselves. And there's no doubt, but somebody has to, still, you have to have a plan. Somebody needs to get the details.
Okay.
And,
I just wanted to
you know, there was an energy committee. It required some help and assistance, and I was the board member who was working with it, and I couldn't provide any more help or assistance. So it was
so not an active consideration.
Absolutely. It's, as you can see it on the planning, it's, you know, I love this project because I think it's good for the environment and it can save us money. I mean, it's
okay,
but you need to plan it out, and there are so many other things that require our attention. It's a definite wish list.
Okay.
Definitely.
Just asking.
Page 10. Denise, on line 225, is that a firm price from the ambulance service?
Yes.
Thank you.
And they have not gone up for 2 years.
Yeah.
I heard a rumor that they might be leaving. Is that true?
I don't know that rumor.
Well, things don't get out there like I do. You know, they're all over the place, and you should be bored yet. You know.
We have a contract.
So we have a contract with them, what, for a year?
Yeah, so I don't know when it's probably.
So when's that up?
Either this June or the following June. You know, there's a how, anyway, there's whatever you need in order to not tie the hands of the people.
Oh, Denise should know all this stuff. She's up with the fire department.
No comment.
But if
no
you
comment.
Do know.
No comment.
No comment. All right, so we know something.
Anything else on 10, page 10? Moving to 11.
I'd like to renew my concern about community assistance to organizations, that we not give general assistance to organizations for services that are reimbursed from other sources, Medicaid, Medicare, United Way. That would be restricted. I want to go on record with that.
We can see the groups that we do provide assistance to.
And many of them are getting reimbursed elsewhere.
Any other comments on 11? Moving to 12. Any other CIP comments or discussion?
So if you want to look at the CIP, we got recommendations from the CIP committee and, you know, made some adjustments as the board just wants to do based on our, you know, what we're doing. So if you look at the sort of the highlighted square cells in each row is the year that we currently are anticipating buying or purchasing that particular item. So you can see that the town hall, while we're putting $20,000 in this year, we're not anticipating spending until 2019. I'll just answer any questions that you might have about the.
Go ahead, Simon.
I hope I have the same thing you have because it says town hall boiler. We really need to be looking at the purchase target date. That's the important thing. Is that not correct?
Well, only to the extent that it's correct.
Oh, because it says.
I see. It does say 2018 because that's what it was, and I forgot to change it, so it should say 2019.
Okay.
The green cell is real. You don't see it as green, but the cell, the highlighted cell, is the. If there's an inconsistency between the purchase target year and the cell, go for the cell.
All right, the cell for 2019 is zero.
Pardon?
I said the cell, yeah, little green cell for the town hall boiler, et cetera.
Yeah, we're not, that's the year we're going to buy it, but we're not needing to put any more money because we've got the 20,000, unless our study this year says that we've been woefully underfunded for it.
Got it.
Okay, yeah, I, that's okay.
Is that, no?
Sort of.
And you can see if I could point you to, under highway department, the second line, the top kick. It had, I think last year it was at 160 and then it sort of got increased 190 based on some conversation or something, and but you know.
Originally we were thinking of going to another big truck until I assessed the roads after seeing with the plows and stuff on. It's not a good idea.
You don't need that behemoth everybody was planning on? No. Okay.
So.
Okay, now I see the pattern. Okay.
Any comments or questions on that?
Can I just ask it, Suzanne? I know that we've only budgeted for 10 years, but I think one of the things that we're having confusion with people who meet with CIP is not thinking out of a 15-year plan. And that, I think that's where Mark was kind of, when we were talking about the new truck, he's saying not in the 10-year plan. And I was trying to explain, we should be thinking 15 years out.
Oh.
The more out, the better. For everyone.
Yeah, especially so for that
size project.
Yeah.
So if I could ask that maybe the board of selectmen will also put that out there, not just the CIP committee.
I think we could do a better job of preparing the CIP committee,
mm-hmm.
you know, and I would like to start all of our budgeting sooner.
Mm-hmm.
I thought we were woefully late this year in getting things together,
mm-hmm.
all across the board, not just in one avenue.
Mm-hmm.
And the same is true for even spending, you know. I want to stop spending, you know, like this, maybe the first week in December, and that's it. You know, figure it out. Come talk to us. You know, I was unhappy with some. I was there. I mean, I was there voting on Monday, but sort of unhappy with an action or two that I voted on. And you know, it's not a good approach. So I've been thinking about that, and I'd like to come up and suggest to the board that we build a timetable, like right away, and let all the department heads know and other committees that and groups that participate in the budgeting process.
Budgeting,
yeah, but also the spec piece too.
Kim and then Vern.
So I want to comment that I'm concerned about the trend, the direction of the budgets. Just doing some back of the envelope math, our town budget has increased in the last 5 years over $700,000 to operate. Just for operating, over $717,000.
With the $350,000 for the roads or without?
So still, I mean, we're talking, you know, in 2014 we're at 1.4 million, now we're at 2.1 million. And then the school in the last 5 years has gone up, you know, 420,000. So we're talking well over $1 million in 5 years. But the town hasn't really changed. The population hasn't changed.
Well, but our revenue has increased.
Not by much, 373,000?
If you look at what our tax effort was in 2017, if you look at the 10-year projections, it was 900 and some odd thousand. We're projecting 901,000, so an increase of only 5,000. You can't just look at the operating budget, Kim, I don't think. You have to look at the whole picture.
I am looking at the whole picture.
Yes.
All these numbers come out of our annual report.
Right. So we're projecting a 2-cent decrease in the municipal tax rate. 2-cent decrease. So yeah, maybe the operating budget is going up because we've put roads in there now, but then we have more revenue. So if there's revenue to support that increase, then your tax rate doesn't go up. And in this case, it goes down by 2 cents, so we estimate.
But there's still a gap of, if you do the numbers in the annual report, you know, there's still a large gap between spending and revenue.
This is what I'm reporting. I mean, this is what gets reported to the DRA. This is what they use to bill their tax rate.
Yep. And this all came out of the reports.
The DRA is what. Not our printed reports. I don't know what to tell you, but our tax rate, we're not anticipating that the municipal tax rate is going to go up. And if you look at the tax rate comparisons that I handed out, we're low. We're not among the high flying towns.
Our school taxes, but that's a different
story. If you even look at the total tax obligation, we're not in the highest quartile for any of them. If you look at the municipal, we're even lower. Part that we're talking to you about today.
Right.
So that's, you see it there. I've also got some information. Can I hand this out for people?
I understand maybe the tax rate has gone up, but assessments have gone up.
Tax rate has gone down.
I understand the tax rate has not gone up, but assessments have gone up. People's property taxes have gone up.
All right. So if you take a look at the 10-year projections, Kim, the tax effort for the town, that's what we pay. So our tax rate, so that's the $906,424 came out to a tax rate for the municipality of $3.24, which was lower than we've been paying, but people's assessed values went up, some people, not everybody. So now that we've readjusted with a revaluation, where we are with our property valuations and the tax rate, we're anticipating that tax effort is going down next year, not up. That's what's, it's a function of your appropriated expenses, it's a function of your revenue, and it's a function of your tax base. So those three items are leading us to estimate that there will be a 2-cent decrease in the municipal tax rate. We can't make estimates on the others. The county tax went up 25% this year. We have zero control over that. They send us a bill, say here.
Okay. Yes, it went down 2 cents, but didn't you also put $50,000 in this year from your reserve, your general fund?
The
unrestricted fund.
Yes, but we've been earmarking $200,000. So this year we're earmarking $50,000, which is $150,000
increase. How much is in that fund balance?
Take a look at the financial statement. I'm not sure.
It's like $248,000.
How much?
$800,000.
No, and I'll add that the school added $119,000 to keep the tax rate low for this coming year. That was from money that we don't get to keep. We could have kept more of it, but we decided we wanted to make sure that enough went back to the town to help keep the tax rate down.
And we see that in the monthly manifest that we get. We got a new one, and our monthly, the monies that we have to shell out, it's tax money, but the town does that piece of it as the reason. Thank you.
And just the reserves, the DRA likes to see
between
at least 7 and 9, right?
Whatever it is, we're within it. Whatever it is, we're sort of like just a little bit below the halfway mark.
Because you have to have enough to cover everything
exactly.
Before you
recommend. We're a little bit below the halfway mark of what they recommend. So we're counting this year on, hopefully we're not going to use any of it, but we do have, instead of 200,000 earmark, we've got 50,000 earmark.
You can't make payroll if you don't have
it. Right.
Any other comments on
Can I just make another comment? If you look at the tax rate comparison sheet, you've seen it. I've got all of the municipalities, which is kind of like not a very useful way to look at it because it includes unincorporated territories or whatever.
Did you send that email?
I did, but here, there's a great comment. There's more. So, you know, if you look at all of the municipalities, including the unincorporated pieces of land, there are 254. But again, so we're in the third and the lowest regardless. But some of those unincorporated places, you know, its value is less than the value of one piece of property in the town of Rollinsford. So that's not terribly useful. The next category is just municipalities that have valuations of at least $50 million. So just kind of screens out some of the really low one. And again, we're in the third lowest quartile for total tax rate and lowest for municipal tax rate. And then if you look at municipalities with the sort of the with valuations that are roughly within our valuations, so 10 up and 10 down, you know, property valuations, where 15 out of 21 for the total tax rate, and we're dead last for the municipal tax rate in that group. If you look at municipalities with a population between 2 and 3,000, total tax rate, we're 17th out of 30th. And the municipal tax rate, we're 26th out of 30th. But you can start to see, if I go back to the municipalities with, that are sort of in our valuation cohort group, 15 out of 21 of those have town managers or administrators, 15 out of 21. If you look at populations with municipalities with a population between 2 and 3,000, 19 out of 31 have a town manager or administrator. And if you look at the greater seacoast, which I just dubbed Stratford and Rockingham counties, so there are 49 municipalities. Our total tax rate, we're 29th out of 49, and municipal, we're 43rd out of 49. And 37 out of 49 of those communities have a town administrator or city or town manager. And if you just look at Stratford, we're 11th out of 13 and 12th out of 14. So, the reason for doing this is just we're going to have to deal with having a town administrator probably sooner rather than later. And it's not unusual for a town our size, it's a town with our property valuation, a town within Stratford County or Rockingham County. It's not unusual.
I just want to acknowledge that I realize that the town has been pretty diligent about keeping costs down. Right, the town has, and the rate has been low. I realize where we are in the state. The real problem we have is the school makes up for it.
Yes, and as you know, we've brought the Rollinsford grade school costs down, which are the only costs we control. They're the only costs we control, and we have brought them down over the last 4 years, each year over the last 4 years.
Yes, go ahead. Yeah, it might be helpful for some of us to attend the county commissioner meetings and public hearings, because the county is now 80% of the municipal, the county tax effort is 80% of the towns. It went up 25% this year. It was another year I was here, but it went up an eye-popping amount again as a rate increase. And so it is now 80% of the towns. It's like whatever it is. It's in your
Suzanne, this is probably a stupid question, but what exactly does the county provide for the
us?
Yes.
You know, I'm not an expert on that. You know, the courts, the nursing home, the
jail.
Yes, the jail, and the enforcement people, the sheriff's department, and the enforcement people that help run all of that. The county extension. They pay part of it, the feds pay part of it. I don't know what the current makeup is. But I don't know. I just know that they provide some information systems. I know the police are plugged in. You know, you may have heard across the years a while before that all got put in place, but I think it's sort of it is now. But that's, you know, it's expensive.
Just as a follow-up, is there some, like when it does go up for eye-popping amounts, is there any explanation that's given when the bill is handed to you, or is it?
Well, they go through the same process. They're public hearings.
Right.
They're public hearings. So we could have known. It was possible for us to be better prepared. Yeah. They manage their work like we manage ours, you know, the similar process. You know, and just from a historical or cultural standpoint or whatever, in many parts of the country, the county is the form of government. Mm-hmm. Library services come from the county, police, fire. We grew up in New England with this little town government.
Schools,
you know, they're not efficient, but you know, it's hard for us to get our minds away from that. They're not efficient because we can't be as efficient as Dover or Rochester or whatever, because we're too tiny, we're too small. And other parts of the country, they have county government.
This is a little on on the Woodlands and Roberts Farm, did you say what scenario you had planned on, or you just, you're
anticipating? Well, Kim had asked for, you know, our plan, so I was just, that was a document that I had created after I'd worked with whatever. So, with a contractor. But George and I, as soon as George got here, we asked him to also work with the contractor.
Mm-hmm.
He has scaled back the work because there are pieces of it, just like Jeff had said, that only require really an overlay. And I can even ask him for details. So what we're going to do, what's not changing, however, is that we will have like a $300,000 paving budget. That's it. So it's going to be, that should cover all of one and some of the other. We don't have quotes yet to figure it out.
Okay.
But that's the plan.
Okay. No, because as I'm looking at scenario one, I'm under the impression that you don't put a top coat on the same year, that you wait.
Well, that's Jody. Jody also said that. So, you know, we can, that's to be determined.
Okay.
Yes.
So,
but
you haven't picked a scenario yet because George hasn't sat down and thought about.
We're waiting for a quote right now.
Okay.
But what's not going to change is we are still likely going to be able to afford to do all of one, and then some of the other. And then we'll finish
mm-hmm.
the other one the following year,
mm-hmm.
assuming that we can put at least, you know, similar amount of money.
Okay.
There are 77 pieces of property on both of those, so it covers a lot of our residents.
And we've got to show their age.
Yeah.
This is a point of information. They're pretty straightforward, with the exception of the beginning part of Robert's farm, where it was filled in and it's settled. And so we may have to do some fill and stabilization, and if you want to say anything more about that, you can. But you know, so that
apparently there was a landfill there, and whatever they put on didn't have the proper base. So we need to dig that out about 3 feet, for about 200 yards, I think, and restabilize that. Put new gravel and proper gravel in to bring the road back up to the height it used to be before it became a roller coaster. The rest of the project over there has some small places that are going to have to be dug out and repaved in, but most of it's going to be overlaid.
Okay.
Instead of grinding the whole road and redoing the whole road. And so you won't have to put two layers. They'll shim and overlay the majority of it, and in that section they'll have to rebuild. And that's what we're waiting on, the cost of what it's going to cost to dig it out. The small parts, it's work that we can do in-house. We can prep the road for them to pave. In the certain areas, we'll have to dig out where there's broken hot top instead of having a grinder come in and do the whole, you know, bring the grinder in for a short job. This is recommended by Pike. It says we can do some of the work. We can do it ourselves. You know, we'll put the gravel in, they'll fine grade it and pave it when they do the road. And we're going to do this, and, you know, working with them. When their plans of being here, we'll, you know, get the road, not so it's done all summer. We want to be ready, you know, within a week of the time they're getting ready to pave it, so.
Okay.
And the other issue on which run is another one that we won't have to do the whole project. The beginning of it's breaking up where most of your traffic is, and that can be ground and repaved. The rest of it we just shim and overlay, according to Chris, like, so there'll be some savings on that stuff. And, you know, like, again, we're going to do a little bit more in-house where we can help out, so.
That section of Sligo Road coming off of Bear Road, going down to, what is going to be, that's rough.
Yeah, I haven't looked at that plan.
No, but that is, you know, I mean, they're going to have a nice, but that is very rough, and you know that. I know that.
Our roads need help.
Well,
so we are painfully aware of that.
And I'm sure there's some small culverts in there that have to be replaced.
Well, there are big culverts on Sligo, too.
Yeah.
in that section.
Bill's not here to talk about the guidelines, so we'll skip that again. Kim was taken care of through Suzanne responding to your request. Do you have something, Brian?
Well, what exactly, what was the update or the proposed change? Is that the fixed asset thing?
No, this is the guidelines.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
What was it, the fixed asset, dollar amount, the lifetime, or something like that?
I don't know.
I think we've disposed of the issue of, you know, who's next in the appointment calendar. So I guess that's the only thing that's left.
I thought we were supposed to talk about the changes that were made, and then Bill hasn't been here for two meetings. So we said to wait until he's here so that we can close this out, is my understanding.
Can you ask him to clarify what he wants to put in here?
Well, that was sent to, like, two meetings ago.
I know, but we voted on two of the items already.
Yeah, but there was something outstanding, which is probably...
I think it was capital item, dollar value.
You've been delaying it, so...
Right.
So, waiting for Bill, I guess.
I'm not sure, because it's been delayed twice, so now I'm not exactly sure of what the... But it was on the agenda three meetings ago, and Bill hasn't been here, and we've been moving it out. So
we'll have to bring it forward.
Right. And then he can answer that specific question. And Kim was all set, so the only thing, the budgeting reporting we know is coming later, and any other business. Yes.
Did we have minutes?
Yes.
Yes. You missed it.
Go ahead, Susan.
So I'm currently logged into the Municipal Association, which has comparative data on municipal jobs. I mean, is there any, I don't want to, it's a new thing, but I mean, if somebody, if we want to spend a couple of minutes looking at just comparative data on jobs, so that you can see what we're up against, we don't have to.
How does it filter the data?
Well, how does it filter the data? So I know there was a question about libraries. So you can do library and then library director. And so here you can see, so Bo, library director's salary.
Is this population filter?
One can. It's not always helpful because we're in the seacoast, right? So we're not buying or competing with, for example, a road agent in Cohos County. We're competing with people who can work in public works anywhere, public or construction, in the seacoast. So that's kind of...
It's variable, though. The filtering by population is static. It looks like they do.
Yes, one can. What is it about the point I made that doesn't suffice?
So I just want to see comparable towns out of size for those positions.
Well,
we can do that, but if they're in Cohos County or Cheshire, it's not relevant, is my only point.
But there may be not big comps for Longford versus Portsmouth.
Mm-hmm. Well, how about Newcastle?
Yeah.
Manbury.
Is Manbury our size?
No.
Are they smaller?
Smaller.
They're smaller.
Not that much.
You think they're smaller?
So here's Brooklyn, 48,000 to 64,000. Pardon?
What?
Right here. 2,000 to 5,000. So Brookline, full-time, 48,000 to 64,000. Canterbury, 30 hours a week at $23.75. Chester, full-time, 40 hours a week at $21.20. Chesterfield, 30 hours per week at $24.45. Epsom, 35 hours a week at $22.47. Fitzwilliam, 33,000 to 45,000. Hampton Falls, 40 hours a week, 40,000 to 41,000.
Is this available for anyone, or do you have to be?
You have to have the PRIVs to do this. Yeah. So
I had requested this data from Sarah, is it?
Well,
I don't know that she has access. I don't know that this is what, but I have access to this, so I thought I could at least show this to you.
So Northampton, 40 hours, $64,000. Warren, $48,000. So Lee, 40 hours, $55,000.
I had requested it through Sarah, which was incorrect, and it should have gone to the Board of Trustees, mm-hmm. Which they sent back saying they would get those, whatever study they use. I don't know if they use this or something else. Right.
So, I mean, if you're just curious about some other jobs.
Is Sarah left 40 hours a week?
I can do something. I can get it down. So library director.
Yeah, that's a great site.
Yep.
But Madison is not exactly in our bailiwick.
Exactly. So you're not going to.
It's a little distant.
Yeah, it's a little distant.
Back up page.
Yes, of course. Yes.
Yep. Brooklyn.
Because you have to report, and these are towns that are not reported. It's a whole list.
So why don't we report it?
It requires.
I don't know.
Aren't you a trustee?
Yeah, I am. A lot of things are kept from
it would be the town that does the reporting, and it's an administrative effort, and it hasn't risen to the top at all.
So it's just the town versus the
yes, the town. It would be us. We would be the ones updating it, because they're all municipal. You wouldn't find teacher here, for example.
So that's the same kind of report that we used to get in a book, and had all the town administrations.
Possibly,
and,
yeah.
They
used to
have
I think they did have. They don't do that anymore.
Come out.
They don't do that anymore. So, anything else?
No.
Okay. I want to go home.
Any other business?
So do we all, but.
No, I'm happy to show something else if there's an interest.
Can I just ask time frame on these? Consistent budgeting reporting, when are we going to have that, by when, and who's going to do it?
Next meeting.
And by whom?
I'm doing it.
Suzanne, head out.
And when's the next meeting?
January
10th.
Yes.
So,
I'm sorry, two warrants, the highway stuff, and two warrant articles?
No. Let's see. There's warrants with appropriations, and the warrants above and beyond this, but the warrants with appropriations are service, highway department service truck, RPD cruiser, roadside mowing attachment, land appraisal, and then for reserve funds, the capital improvement reserve fund, the culvert reserve fund, the conservation land
right
trust
here,
fund.
These
okay.
Things.
Okay. Thank you. They're all, they're here.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Yes, I want to keep going.
Crash chickens, everybody.
Give a piece of Corey. He really needs it. That's very good.
Oh, yes.